Thank you, guys. So, first of all, the audience here. How is the audience? Is it high, low, good? Okay, good. So, thanks for the introduction. So, as he said, I work as a research engineer in Yahoo Labs. And all this stuff which I'm showing you has nothing to do with my day job. All these are just hobbies. And to explain all this in just one word, you have to read my t-shirt. I think you got it. Okay, so let's start. And this is the agenda. And as I said, let's start with the demo. So I have this little buddy here. And I'm gonna control that using my Android. Okay, so it's slightly difficult controlling it with one hand. Okay, let it take a left turn. Okay, come back. It's a little shy now, it's going towards that. Say hello. Okay, so I think you get that idea there. So, if somebody wants to play with this, maybe just contact me after the talk. You can play around with this, you can control it, and all that stuff. So, let's get into the talk now. And let me just switch it off a bit. Just around a year back, I got fascinated by Arduino and then Android. And then I was like trying to make them talk to each other and stuff like that. And so, the talk which I'm going to do today is mostly for an Android user perspective or an Android developer perspective. So, as I said, the talk which I'm going to give now is mostly for an Android developer, right? So, I'm not going to talk much about the hardware details. I'm just going to give you an overview of the hardware details. And provided that you already have on board, how you're going to control that using Android. Also, I'm going to talk about different techniques which you can use to efficiently interact with the external world using your Android phone, right? By external world, I mean any device which you want to control over, okay? So, let's start then. So, you already saw the demo. So, the entire source code for it, both the Android source code as well as the Arduino source code is there on GitHub. Maybe I'll also post the schematic for it. The schematic is very simple. It's just that I'm too lazy to upload it there, so I'll upload it pretty soon. And so let's go ahead. So if you take any robot, for instance, a robot could be something which is very complex or a very simple line-following robot or even an electronic arm or the ones which are used in the manufacturing plants, any robot for you to take, for instance, it basically has this anatomy. So you have a bunch of sensors, and then you have a processor, and then you have the motors. So what is going to happen is this robot, so the processor is like the brain of it, right? So it's going to take all this, or it's going to interact with the external world, both by using the sensors as well as the motors. The sensors are like input to your computer program. Right, so if you have any computer program, you're going to have an input which you're going to process and then you're going to give some output. The same thing for a robot. So you have some sensors, you read state from an external world by reading those sensors and then you do some logic, you process it and then you control the external world using the motors. Okay? So, as I said, Android, you know, it's pretty simple. You have a very simple phone. But it's pretty powerful, right? So it can act as a sensor. So you already know about most of the sensors which are there in Android, right? You have a camera, you have an accelerometer, you have a three-axis orientation meter. You have GPS which can pinpoint where exactly you are. You have GSM data which you can process, and you have a whole lot of whole lot of sensors which you can use. I think you also talked about you know, Adrija also talked about the new features in camera and stuff like that, right? So you have a whole bunch of sensors which you can use. And for the processor part, you can basically write your app in the native Java code if you are familiar with Java. Or if you just want to just control some stuff and you don't want to really get into Android development, I think most of you would hear about Android scripting there, right? So you can use that as well. So in Android scripting, you can probably use Python, JavaScript, I guess you can use Lua, the whole slew of languages which you can use as well. So when comparing with the previous slide, right, of an anatomy of a robot, so you have what? You have a sensor and the processor. So the missing part is the motor. And that's where Arduino comes in. Because Arduino is very good in dealing or in controlling different motors for you. And what is Arduino? So how many of you have heard about Arduino before? Wow, that's really good. So for the benefit of the people who don't know about Arduino, it's a combination of hardware and software which you can use to create hardware-based programs. Okay? So I think that most of you are pretty young, so I'm not sure if you've known about Visual Basic. So around maybe when I started my career, we had this program called Visual Basic, which is supposed to be the most familiar or the most favorite language of Bill Gates, I guess, in those days. That's how it was marketed. So Visual Basic was a tool which enabled people to create desktop applications without actually getting into the event loop and stuff like that. So all the hard part of desktop programming was abstracted out for you, and you just have to drag and drop to create desktop applications. The same thing they have done for hardware programming. So you can consider Arduino as a Visual Basic for hardware programming. So it basically contains a small board with a lot of input and output pins and a processor. And these input and output pins you can access from your program. So you also have another language called Arduino, which is very similar to C. Okay? And you have a lot of library functions which you can use to read input, to write output, and stuff like that. So reading input, you can read sensor values, and writing output, you can control motors, servo motors, DC motors, and whole lot of stuff. Okay, so now we have Android, which has the sensor and the processor part, and we have Arduino, which is the motor part. And now what we are gonna do, just like make them talk, and then you have your robot. So I'm just going to talk about different ways by which you can make both an Android and Arduino talk to each other, right? So there's a whole lot of ways by which you can do. And throughout this presentation, as I said before, I'm going to concentrate mostly from an Android perspective, how you can talk, right? And believe me, I'm not showing any code here. These are just techniques which I've used and some advantages and disadvantages for each of those methods. So basically each method is gonna have its own advantages and disadvantages, and based on your case or use case, you can decide on which one to take up. Okay, so I'm just gonna talk about that. So first is Bluetooth. And this little buddy which I showed you is running on Bluetooth. So what I'm gonna do is, I have an Android phone, and this has an Arduino board and two DC motors. The two DC motors are the ones which are controlling the wheels. And then it has an Arduino board, and then the battery, which is the bulk part of it. And then you have an X-Bridge, which is a small microcontroller which controls the two DC motors. Okay? So all these are just like pre-built PCBs. I haven't done any PCB design and stuff like that. I just like connected wires. Just like how you connected breadboard, I just like connected all the ways. I haven't done anything fancier than this. Okay, so as I said, this is how this works. So the Bluetooth part, what you need is a Bluetooth shield, right? For those of you who have used Arduino, you know about the concept of shields. So shield is an add-on for Arduino. And there are a variety of shields which are available, and each shield provides a different functionality to Arduino. And in this case, you need a Bluetooth shield. And then there is an open source library called Ambrino, which is a combination of Arduino library and Android library. And that's the same thing which I'm using for this particular robot as well. So you can use that to connect both your Arduino and Android. So the way it works is, you have a jar file for your Android, which you have to just drag and drop into your Android project. And for the Arduino side, you have a library which you put in the library folder, and then they give you a predefined set of methods which you have to call to establish the connection. And it's, believe me, it's just like 3 or 4 lines of code to set up a working Bluetooth connection. Okay? And you can also check out the code in my GitHub. So what are the advantages of using Bluetooth? So first, you don't need a wired connection. So here I was controlling the bot from my phone, and it's not wired, right? So it's easy for me to control it and stuff like that. So first advantage is it doesn't need a wired connection. The second is it can work from Android 1.5. So there are other methods which doesn't work on the latest phones, but which work only on the latest phones. So this is one of the major advantages. Okay. So the third advantage is it's a two-way communication. You can send data from Arduino back to Android, as well as you can transmit data from Android to Arduino. You can do two-way communication as well. And a couple of disadvantages which are like, which is basically equivalent to any Bluetooth communication, right? So you have power consumption which is pretty high for Bluetooth transaction, and it's slightly slower when you compare with other connection types. I would show you other connection types where it's like slightly faster, but Bluetooth is generally very slow. And the range is also pretty limited. I think probably when I tried it outside the auditorium, I was able to control my bot maybe for around like 25 to 30 feet, not beyond that. So that's a range which you can expect for Bluetooth. And by the way, if you guys have any questions, just drop me right away there. Or you can also contact me after this talk, but if it's something which can be answered at that particular context, then do stop me. Yes. Yes, that's what I tried to do. I haven't tried it before, I was just trying to see how long I can control it. So with a Bluetooth SWIFT board, I was able to control 225 feet.
Because they say something like 100 meters or something.
Yeah, that's what the spec said. That's what the spec said, but I could. I mean, till 25 feet, it was working without any practice.
Excuse me, where do you get this Arduino board and the motors?
Okay, so all the stuff which I've used here, I've got it from SP Road in Bangalore. And I can also give you the shop names if you want. So the Arduino board, the original board cost around $1,400, and there is a shop called NSK which have original boards, and you can also get duplicate boards for $700. But the point is, they clearly tell you that this is a duplicate board and this is an original board, so you won't be ripped off. That I'm pretty sure. The batteries I got from Ohm Electronics, I think this is some $600. And the edge bridge and the case and the wheel and the DC motor, I got it from Ohm Electronics again. Yeah, and there's a whole slew of online shops from where you can get it. I think there's 9 circuits, there is there. TechNet, I don't know how you pronounce it. They also had a booth here. Believe it or not, there's like a bunch of people from here you can buy it. But if you are one of those people who want to buy it, after seeing them, you can go to SP Road. Mm. And you can have a nice shopping on a Saturday evening or whatever. Yeah, you can also be there. Okay, so moving on. So the next way by which you can control or do the communication is using Wi-Fi. Okay, for Wi-Fi again, you need something called a Wi-Fi shield, which is available for Arduino. And the other requirement obviously is that you should have a working Wi-Fi connection, and both your Android as well as Arduino should be connected to the same Wi-Fi network or whatever. So my initial plan was to make this board using Wi-Fi, then I moved on to Bluetooth because using Wi-Fi is very difficult to give demos, especially in a conference like this where there are like a whole slew of things which you have to take into account when you connect to Wi-Fi and stuff like that. But Arduino as such has very good support for Wi-Fi as well as Ethernet connection. So if you have some requirement regarding that, you can still use that. And so the usual advantages, so it's not wired, and two-way communication is possible, and it can work from any device from which is running on one Android 1.5 and above.
Hello? Yes, can you use Wi-Fi Direct for it? I mean, without any access points or anything?
Okay, I came to know about Wi-Fi Direct just a couple of hours before. I would definitely check that. And when he was giving the talk about it, that's the same thing which was running in my mind. So I'm just definitely going to check it tonight when I go. And I would, right now I don't have an answer for it, but I can give you an answer once I find that.
And you say Wi-Fi shield and Bluetooth shield, and maybe next you say USB shield, but all these shields are different, or do we get everything in one sheet?
No, all these are different sheets. So Arduino is like your base, what do you call it, base platform, and these. So you can compare this with your Firefox. Okay? Firefox, you get a default browser. And then for each functionality, you add an add-on to it. Right? So similarly, and Arduino just comes up with a bar board. And then for each of the functionality which you want, you can buy those sheets and then add them on top of that.
What about Google Sheet?
Yeah, I have a slide about that. So they have this concept of ADK, right? So I'm also going to talk about that as well. So, any questions so far, till now? Yes? Okay, so on the Arduino side, you have a pre-built library, as well as a shield, which are all open source. And in the Android side, it's just like, you know, you have to use like a socket. So you will have an IP, and then you can open a socket and then start communicating with that.
How many shields can you put in?
Sorry?
How many shields?
Can we stack on top of each other? Technically, there's no limit, unless and until two shields are going to use the same pin. Even if they're going to use the same pin, there's another shield which can prevent that. So, technically, you don't have a limit. It's just, you can keep stacking stuff on top of each other. I've seen, personally, I've tried around six shields on top of each other, on top of Arduino. I've seen people who are using more than 10 shields. And they have their own web server running on top of Arduino. So, with authentication and stuff like that. Okay, so next is using the USB cable. I think most of you would have seen the Google I.O. presentation which happened last time, right? The last Google I.O. So the new thing which really excited me personally was the introduction of ADK. The accessory development kit which Google introduced. So they have this concept where you can create your own accessories to Android phones, and they can be, so I think in the demo video which they showed, they were talking about treadmills which can talk to Android and lighting systems which can talk to Android. They also had this concept of Android at home where you can control a whole slot of devices using Android. So the basic ADK kit which they show the demo is running on Android, it's Arduino. Both Android and Arduino, it already confuses things there. Okay, so this Arduino or this ADK board which Google introduced is nothing but an Arduino board and a USB sheet combined together into a single board. And I think it costs around 7,000 rupees or 8,000 rupees if you actually want to try it out. Yeah, something around that. But you can buy your own Arduino, and then you can also buy your own USB sheet, and then use it as an ADK as well. Yes. No. So far, I have tried only Arduino. And so you can use that as an ADK as well. Okay. So you don't necessarily have to buy an ADK kit. You can also use Arduino and USB sheet together. So that's what I said. You either need an ADK kit, or you can buy Arduino and use the host sheet and then use that as an ADK sheet. So towards the end of the presentation, I have a link where I explain you how to use a normal standard Arduino and USB host sheet as ADK kit as well. So what are the advantages of this? It has native support in Android, backed by Google. So you get all those framework advantages. It's not hacky. It's part of the framework and stuff like that. And it's pretty fast. The amount of data which you can transmit is also pretty high. I mean, the frequency which you can transmit the data is also pretty high. and it's fault tolerant and all that. So because since it's part of the framework itself, you get a lot of advantages. And the other major advantages, or the other common advantage, is that it's a two-way communication. So your Android phone can talk to your ADK, and the ADK can talk back to your Android phone, right? But the major disadvantage, which I personally feel, is that it works only in Gingerbread and above. So your phone, you have to have the latest phone, okay? And obviously, you also need a wired connection for it. So this is a slight variation. This technique is a slight variation of using ADK. So this also works by the USB cable, but the advantage in this is it can run from any phone from 1.5. This is very similar to ADK, and this concept was done way before ADK was introduced. And if I'm not wrong, I think ADK was based on this. Not based on this, it was influenced by this. That's the reason why actually Google came up with the concept of ADK. So there is this open source library called MicroBridge, which allows you to talk between an Android phone and an Arduino. The way that you do this is pretty interesting. I think as an Android developer, most of you would have heard about Logcat, right? The default logging mechanism by which you do. So what they have done is they open a socket from the Arduino side, and when you plug your Android device into it, you can read from the log files. So if you have to communicate from your Android to Arduino, you just do log.d or whatever, log.d or log.d or whatever. And then it basically, and then the Arduino can read it. And it's the same way, there's a socket which is open from Arduino side, and Android can talk through that socket. Or you can write a file on the SD card, which Android can read again. So that's how this communication works. So this library has completely abstracted it out for you. So you just have to call two functions for reading and writing. And the main advantage is it works on older versions of Android as well. And as again, it has a two-way communication. But the slight disadvantage of this approach is that, which I think I have not put in the slide, is that it's like slightly slower when you compare with other approaches. Because ADK has native support in Android, but this is through Logcat and file access and stuff like that. So if you want something, if you want a real-time update and real-time communication between Android and Arduino, then you can't use this approach. But if you're just going to try some, as a hobby or something like which is not time-critical, then you can use this approach. And you can also use it with older phones. And then, this personally is my favorite. You can actually talk to an Arduino board from your Android using the audio jacket or the audio pin in your phone. So I think most of your phone will have an audio output, right? You can actually communicate from your Android to your Arduino or to any other device. You basically can send data out using your audio jacket. So the way it works is every file, I think, has 64, for every minute or every second, it actually has 64 bit. The audio data is represented in 64 bit. So you can encode your data as a WAV format, and then you play it in your Android phone, and that is given as an output. And then you have an audio pin that reads that and then decodes it. If I'm not wrong, this is the same approach which is used by Tata IndiCom for their Tata Sky app. So they give you this small thing which you plug into your audio output of your phone, and then you can use your phone as a remote. So what they have done is they have this miniature version of Arduino inside that, and which reads the data out and then kind of gives the data to an IR sender. That IR sender is actually acting as a remote. So pretty interesting things can be done. There is also another company which has created an entire credit card processing system based on this approach. You can use your phone as a credit card scanner, and that's being done with this. And the main advantage is the size is very small. So if you look at the device, it's just that the audio jacket with mail pin, so that is the thing which is bigger than the entire package. So that's something which you can try. But the one disadvantage is it's a one-way communication. It's very difficult for you to communicate back from Arduino into Android. And so it has the user usual advantages. It's very compact. The power consumption is very less and stuff like that. And one disadvantage again is like it's slightly difficult to work with because you have to encode your entire data in wave format. So it's again so the easy way to do it is for every command you can create a wave file and then store it in your SD card and make your Android app play it. Or the other option is you have to generate it dynamically, which I think is slightly more complicated to do on an Android phone. But a lot of interesting stuff has been happening around this. You might probably want to check that out as well. And then this is actually a no-brainer. So your phone is at the end of the day is a phone, so it can receive SMS and can receive calls. So similarly for Arduino, you have something called GSM sheet, which is another sheet, which is going to act as a, which basically adds the GSM capabilities. So you can put a SIM card to it, and in your phone you already have a SIM card, so you do the transfer using SMS, or you can even make a call and then do the transfer, right? So if anytime you want to send data from Arduino to Android or from Android to Arduino, you basically send SMSs back. So it's pretty simple. Range is unlimited as long as you are willing to pay for the SMS. And it's very simple to set up, you don't have much to do. And the other advantages, the main disadvantages is that there's a potential for abuse. Now anybody who knows the number or all these banks which call you up for free credit card and free SMSs and stuff like that can screw up your robot. So that's the only disadvantage which I can think of. Yeah, so again, you cannot do real-time data transfer here, right? So it has to be slightly slower. So actually an interesting use case of this, there was this, I wouldn't call it a bot, but there was this project based on Arduino, which is like essentially, they have a small wire which is plugged into the soil of a flower pot. And then they try to send a signal or send a voltage from one wire to the and try to listen it from the other wire. If the sand is wet, then it is transmitted. And if it's not wet, it's not transmitted. So what happens is as soon as the signal breaks, the Arduino board sends a tweet. So it's basically for the plant pot or whatever like that. So the idea is that the plant is going to tweet saying that I need water. So the other, you know, apart from the hobby, or the real use case is that whenever there is going to be landslides, so they have these small, inexpensive sensors placed, and whenever there is going to be any of these catastrophic events going to happen, you get signals or you get emails or you get SMS or some way you get notified and stuff like that.
Yes. Send the SMS to start the AC before you reach
the
phone.
Yeah, so you have probably seen the ads where you control your AC using SMS or whatever. So you send an SMS and the AC automatically switches on. Stuff like that. Okay, so moving on. I think yesterday there was this talk about cloud to device messaging, right? So you can use that as well for communicating between Arduino and Android. So the way this works is, on the Arduino side, you need a Wi-Fi shield or an Ethernet shield. So this can make a call to a server program. So, and this server program can initiate the C2DM messaging. So you get the notification from your server to your device based on the C2DM framework. So once you get a notification, you can decide on what to do and stuff like that. There are I actually included this just for the sake of completeness, because this technique is, not very useful if you ask me in my opinion, because there are a lot of additional setup which you have to do and it's not real time and there are a lot of issues with this. First is you need, so your Arduino should have the capability to ping a server, right? And after that you should have C2DM setup in your phone. And apart from that, the C2DM message cannot contain, I think, more than 1024 bytes or something like that. So you can only send a notification, but if you need to send a lot of data, then you have a problem here. So I just like included this for the sake of completeness. If you really want to try it out, you can try it out, and maybe there is one use case for which this is an ideal solution as well. So you have the usual advantages and disadvantages. So the main disadvantage is that you should have an Android phone which is prior and above, because C2DM is supported only in those phones. Okay, so these are some of the options which are available. Yes, I have a question here. Or is it my voice which was echoing to back to you? Okay. So these are some of the other options which you have for communication. So I think you also heard about NFC today. So you can use NFC. So I had an interesting conversation with the person who had the booth outside yesterday. So this NFC reader which they have is actually a USB device. Right? At the end of the day, it's just a USB device which you can communicate over USB or serial over USB. And Arduino has another shield called USB host shield, which can act as a USB host. So the person who was having the booth there, he actually connected his NFC reader to a laptop, right? So a cheap laptop would cost you around 30K, but an Arduino with an SD card sheet would cost you less than 2K. And if you add a USB host shield, the cost would come somewhere around 3,000 to 4,000. And using this combination, you can do the entire stuff which you were doing using a laptop. So that's a business idea. If somebody want to pursue it, you can pursue it. So the basic idea is that you connect your any USB USB accessory or any USB device to Arduino, and then you can read, write data. Or if you want to store data, you can store it on an SD card and do stuff like that. So the second option is using a computer as an intermediate thing. So Arduino can talk to computer using a USB cable, and then you can figure out how you want to communicate between your phone and your computer. You can do it Wi-Fi, or you can also use a wired connection again. So these are not like very useful setup, but maybe for debugging, when you actually want to do debugging or if you want to do a prototype, then probably try out these steps. The other third one is a pretty interesting thing. I think the tablets which are running Honeycomb have USB host support. So in those cases, what happens, generally when you connect your Android phone to any device, your Android phone is gonna act as an accessory. It's not the server. So USB protocol has a server and a client concept. So one is the host, which is like the server, and the other one is the accessory or the client. When you connect your Android phone is going to act as an accessory. And your keyboard, mouse, everything is an accessory. Your computer would act as a host, right? But starting from Honeycomb, Android tablets have the capability of being a USB host. In those cases, your Arduino board becomes an accessory. So you can directly plug it and then start the communication. So that's again one possibility which you can try. I don't physically have an access to a tablet yet, so I haven't tried it out, but that's something which you can do. But I'm not sure what are the practical problems there, but we can probably share that out as well.
You can try that out using Android extensions.
Sorry, somebody say it.
You can try it using Android extensions.
Yes, you can try doing that as well. There's another interesting use case which you can do. If you want to try out ADK, right? ADK is the accessory development kit, and you don't want to get messier with the hardware, you can use your computer as an accessory, because you have a USB connection, so it can act both as a host as well as a client. Now what happens is you connect your phone to your computer, and your computer, in the computer you can read it using a serial or USB port. So if you're using Python, you can use PySerial or PyUSB, and then your entire computer itself can act as a accessory for your Android phone. So I'm trying something around that lines. Maybe if I have some updates, I'll post it somewhere. I think it's already been done using C. I'm just trying out using Python and trying to see if I can completely eliminate the hardware part for doing your accessory development. So well, I think we are almost done with the presentation. So the summary is this: don't throw away your older Android phones. So you can play around with it, you can do stuff like this. You know, believe it or not, any Android phone which you have has more capabilities than, you know, I'm not very sure, I read it somewhere, but I'm not sure how accurate it is. When NASA launched the satellite, or when they launched the 3 astronauts to the moon, the entire computation power which they had was less than the Android phone which you have right now. I'm not sure if it's entirely true or not, but maybe it could be relatively true as well. So you have so much potential in your hand, so, and just like your imagination, and you can do amazing stuff as well. So that's almost done with the presentation. So these are some of the links to the stuff which I talked about. So links to the libraries, you know, the sheets which I talked about and stuff like that. So I think I'm done, and I'm done with the time. So any questions? So this is running, this is not running on UNO, this is the previous version, the one which is previous to UNO. But most of the versions of Arduino doesn't really matter, because the only difference is the amount of memory which these boards have. So as long as you're not doing anything which is really complex, any of these boards should work. But I've personally tried Mega, UNO, and Decimeter, which is the one which is just before UNO.
Hi sir, is it necessary to be an Android phone?
Technically, no. It can be
any
phone. It cannot even be a phone. It can be even your TV remote. It can be your Wii remote. Any device which is capable of sending an IR signal or a Bluetooth signal, whatever. So the only reason why I concentrated mostly on the Android side is that, just for the reason that this is an Android conference.
Are you trying interfacing Arduino with any of the home appliances?
Home appliances? I've tried it out with my ceiling fan lights and stuff like that. So there is this relay. So you have the relay which basically, because all your lights are going to be on 230 volt, right? And Arduino is running on 5 volt. So I have this 5 volt to 230 volt relay which can basically control my light and fan and stuff like that. And to the Arduino side, I interface it with my TV remote. So normal TV remote, I use it to control my fan, light, and one day my door probably. Sorry? Not yet. I would probably upload it to YouTube pretty soon. I was not sure if anybody would be really interested in doing seeing that, but since there is interest now, I would upload it to YouTube. I'll start uploading most of the demos on YouTube now.
Which Arduino board did you use for home appliance? The same one?
The same one. So you can use UNO or the previous one. It doesn't really matter, actually. You can also use the duplicate ones if you find in SEO. They also work. And there are some boards which have additional functionalities. Meaning duplicates. You can still use it. For IR, you don't need a shield per se, you just need the IR receiver. And the IR receiver is just like what, 5 rupees or something? Just need the IR receiver. And then you can connect, so it basically has 3 pins. Maybe then you can take it offline, but it's pretty easy to interface. That's just 3 lines, and then you connect it, and you get read the data and do whatever you want. IR, the TV remote which I use has a range of around, maybe like, somewhere on that, from 20 feet, 20 to 25 feet. But it needs line of sight.
We are done with our time of questions. If you have more questions, you can take it offline. So let's give a round of applause for Sukhdeep.
Thank you. Thank you guys, and I'm just going to have my buddy outside, so if somebody want to play with it, you can still do it. Thank you.
Oh, you're going to be swamped. Everyone of us are going to come now to play.
Thank you.